This is Democracy Now!
The reality is December and January and February are going to be rough times. I actually believe they're going to be the most difficult time in the public health history of this nation.
Record shattering. Over 2,800 people died in the United States Thursday from COVID-19 as infections, deaths, and hospitalizations from the pandemic reach record highs with no signs of slowing down. Researchers are now warning the U.S. death toll may near 540,000. That's over 500,000 dead by April. Today, we'll speak with one of the world's leading infectious disease doctors, Paul Farmer, the co-founder of Partners in Health.
All of these epidemics find their way to exploit social disparities and inequalities and take their greatest harvest around among the poor and vulnerable. The question we're asking is that the case? Does that need to be the case? And of course, the answer is no, it does not.
Dr. Paul Farmer will talk about the pandemic, healthcare inequality, and his new book, Fevers, Feuds, and Diamonds, Ebola and the Ravages of History. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The United States has set yet another world record for daily coronavirus cases, hospitalizations, and deaths, with over 216,000 infections confirmed Thursday and more than 2,800 deaths. Nearly 101,000 people are hospitalized with COVID-19 across the U.S. In California, Governor Gavin Newsom has imposed sweeping remain-at-home orders covering the vast majority of California's population.
Just in the last 14 days, close to 1,000 Californians have lost their lives due to COVID-19. The bottom line is, if we don't act now, our hospital system will be overwhelmed. If we don't act now, we'll continue to see a death rate climb.
Governor Newsom's order came a day after Los Angeles Mayor Eric Garcetti warned Los Angeles is nearing a devastating tipping point, ordering residents to remain at home and skip social gatherings in order to prevent needless suffering and death. In Rhode Island, officials have opened two field hospitals with a combined 900 beds to relieve hospitals as COVID cases hit new record highs. Rhode Island Governor Gina Raimondo says the problem now is finding enough medical workers to handle the surge. On Thursday, she appealed to retired and unemployed healthcare workers to join the effort. President-elect Joe Biden has nominated Vivek Murthy to serve as U.S. Surgeon General to help lead the response to the coronavirus crisis. Murthy previously served as Surgeon General for over 2 years under President Obama. On Thursday, Biden told CNN he'll order new public health measures as soon as he takes office.
The first day I'm inaugurated to say I'm going to ask the public for 100 days to mask. Just 100 days. To mask, not forever, 100 days. And I think we'll see a significant reduction if that occurs with vaccinations and masking to drive down the numbers considerably.
Researchers at the University of Washington project the U.S. coronavirus death toll could reach nearly 540,000 by April 1st. The same researchers recently projected that if 95% of Americans wore masks consistently, over 68,000 lives would be saved by March 1st. Italy recorded 993 new COVID-19 deaths Thursday, a daily record. The Italian government's declared a national curfew and said Thursday it will bar people from traveling between regions over the Christmas and New Year holidays. Iran's official coronavirus cases count topped 1 million on Thursday. In October, a member of Iran's medical association said the true death toll in Iran could be 4 times higher than the official number, which now stands at nearly 50,000. In the Gaza Strip, officials have ordered schools and mosques to close as part of a partial lockdown, as more than 800 new COVID-19 cases were confirmed Thursday. Among those infected are senior members of Hamas, including its leader, Yahya Sinwar. At the United Nations, Secretary General Antonio Guterres warned Thursday the world could be suffering negative effects from the pandemic for decades to come.
Let's not fool ourselves. A vaccine cannot undo damage that will stretch across years, even decades to come. Extreme poverty is rising. The threat of famine looms. We face the biggest global recession in 8 decades.
Back in the United States, California's farm workers have contracted COVID-19 at nearly 3 times the rate of other state residents. That's according to a new study by the University of California, Berkeley researchers, the first report to explore how farm workers are disproportionately affected by the pandemic. The report also found farm workers who only spoke an indigenous language had higher positivity rates than farm workers who spoke Spanish or English. Wisconsin Supreme Court Thursday refused to hear the Trump campaign's lawsuit seeking to disqualify nearly 250,000 ballots in Wisconsin's largest Democratic counties. The Trump campaign's lost or withdrawn at least 28 lawsuits seeking to invalidate the results of the 2020 election. White House Communications Director Alyssa Farah has resigned her post. She served in the role for just 240 days. Meanwhile, President Trump tweeted late Thursday he'll veto the massive $740 billion National Defense Authorization Act because Republican senators refused to include an amendment to strip legal protections for social media companies. Trump is demanding the repeal of Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act to punish Twitter and Facebook, which he has accused of censoring his false and misleading tweets about the coronavirus and the 2020 election. The U.S. is pulling dozens of staff from its embassy in Baghdad ahead of the anniversary of the Trump-ordered assassination of Iranian General Qasem Soleimani. It's unclear whether the move will be permanent and comes as tensions are flaring in the region following the killing of Iran's top nuclear scientist last week. Egypt has freed 3 human rights workers from prison amidst international outcry over an unprecedented crackdown on activists and journalists. Ghasser Abdelrazek was arrested at his home last month, just days after 2 other staffers for the Egyptian Initiative for Personal Rights were also arrested. They'd recently hosted foreign diplomats to discuss human rights abuses in Egypt. In Bangladesh, human rights advocates are condemning the relocation of thousands of Rohingya refugees to an isolated island hours away from the mainland. Police Thursday escorted refugees who were put on buses for the long trek from Cox's Bazar to a port town where they'll be put on boats en route to Basanchar Island, which is prone to flooding, frequent cyclones, and only emerged from the ocean 2 decades ago. The island's never been inhabited. 2 aid workers told Reuters refugees were pressured into move by government officials who threatened them or offered them cash in exchange. Human Rights Watch called the refugees' relocation, quote, nothing short of a dangerous mass detention of Rohingya people in violation of international human rights obligations. In immigration news, NBC News reports attorneys tasked with reuniting children separated from their families at the U.S.-Mexico border have finally been given key information critical to finding the children's relatives after months of pleading for the information. Documents filed in federal court in California last week say attorneys have now obtained phone numbers and other data that had not previously been made available by the Trump administration. This comes as lawyers say they've found the parents of nearly 40 children among 666 refugee kids whose families they could not track down. The children were taken away from their families between April and June 2018 at the height of Trump's zero-tolerance family separation policy. In more immigration news, the Arizona Republic reports dozens of asylum seekers and allies led a protest Wednesday in the border sister cities of Nogales, Sonora and Nogales, Arizona, demanding President-elect Joe Biden restore asylum proceedings. Nearly 80 people marched side by side, separated by the massive border wall. Asylum seekers remain stuck on the Mexican side as the Trump administration has used COVID-19 as a pretext to suspend asylum claims. Asylum seekers are also urging Joe Biden to kill other Trump policies, including the Remain in Mexico program, which has forced tens of thousands of asylum seekers to stay in Mexico while their asylum cases are resolved in U.S. courts. The U.S. has banned cotton imports from a major Chinese producer, which it accuses of using the slave labor of imprisoned Uyghur Muslims in Xinjiang province. China's denied the accusation. In related news, formerly imprisoned Uyghurs have said they were forced to consume pork, which is prohibited in Islam, among other abuses. In India, demonstrators formed a human chain in the city of Bhopal Wednesday to commemorate the lives lost and renew calls for justice in the deadliest industrial disaster in history. In 1984, a toxic gas leak from the Union Carbide pesticide factory killed an estimated 20,000 people and poisoned another 500,000. The U.S. company and its parent firm, Dow Chemical, have refused to pay for cleanup. This is activist Rachna Dhingra speaking at the protest.
Up until today, people have been fighting for a life of justice and honor, and they are fighting because both the state and the federal government have closed their eyes and ears. There is still poisonous water today. The gas victims have not received proper compensation for the problems that they have been facing for a lifetime.
The Trump administration has announced plans to sell oil drilling rights in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge for the first time. The January 6th lease sales could complicate President-elect Joe Biden's pledge to permanently protect the pristine region, which is extremely rich in biodiversity and has been home to indigenous people for thousands of years. In Southern California, two firefighters were injured as a wildfire east of Irvine exploded in size Thursday, fueled by fierce Santa Ana winds and bone-dry conditions. The bonfire has burned over 6,400 acres and is only 10% contained. Over 4 million acres have burned across California so far this year, shattering all previous records. In Georgia, Republican Senator David Perdue has traded stocks, bonds and mutual funds nearly 2,600 times over the past 6 years, often in companies within his Senate committee's oversight. That's according to The New York Times, which reports Perdue has been the Senate's most prolific stock trader by far, sometimes reporting 20 or more transactions in a single day. Perdue faces Democratic challenger John Ossoff in a January 5th runoff election in Georgia that'll determine the balance of power in the Senate. In more news from Georgia, Florida attorney Bill Price faces a felony investigation after he urged fellow Republicans to violate the law by registering to vote in Georgia. The investigation follows these remarks Price made in early November in a since-deleted Facebook Live video.
We have to win on January 5th, and I will invite each and every one of you to be my roommate in Georgia. I'm moving to Georgia. I'm changing my voter registration right now, and I'm inviting 2 million people to be my roommate.
Under Georgia state law, it's a felony punishable by up to 10 years in prison to register to vote as a non-resident without proper qualifications. Price later told reporters in Atlanta he was only making, quote, humorous comments, but election officials in Georgia's Paulding County say Price did, in fact, register to vote at his brother's address. A debate between Senator Loeffler and Reverend Warnock will take place on Sunday night. In Philadelphia, a black mother who was attacked with her family in October by a horde of police officers is speaking out about the harrowing experience. Rekia Young was driving an SUV with her two-year-old son and teenage nephew when officers descended on the vehicle, broke all the windows, assaulted and arrested Young, pulled her 16-year-old nephew from the car, and grabbed her child, who suffered a bump on his head from the assault. Rekia Young says she and her young son are physically and emotionally traumatized.
He's petrified, and he's only 2 years old. My mom and my nephew asked him what happened. He was saying, car, door. Open door and up there banging his hand. Like, as if, like, you know, the cops was banging on the car. He just kept repeating it. Like, he's still trying to tell the story. Like, he acts out, he bite his nails, he pull his hair nail. He never did those things before. He's traumatized. He is going through something. He knows words, but he can't express to me how he's feeling.
Democrats introduced a resolution Wednesday to amend a clause in the 13th Amendment that bans the enslavement of people with the exception of, quote, involuntary servitude as punishment for being convicted of a crime. Racial justice advocates have long argued the clause is a loophole that's allowed new forms of slavery in the United States and have likened mass incarceration to slavery as prisoners are forced into harsh labor for the profit of private prison companies. And the ceremony for the Right Livelihood Awards, also known as the Alternative Nobel Prize, was held Thursday. Four winners share the honor this year: indigenous rights and environmental activist Lottie Cunningham Wren of Nicaragua, Belarusian pro-democracy activist Alice Bilyaski, U.S. civil rights lawyer Brian Stevenson, and Iranian human rights lawyer Nasreen Sotoudeh, who was returned to prison one day before the ceremony after being temporarily released last month due to her worsening health and because of COVID conditions in Iran. Brian Stevenson was presented his award by Anthony Ray Hinton, who spent 30 years on death row for a crime he did not commit and now works alongside Stevenson at the Equal Justice Initiative in Alabama. This is Stevenson speaking at the ceremony.
I work in a country that has the highest rate of incarceration in the world. I work against a system that treats you better if you're rich and guilty than if you're poor and innocent. We work to overturn this horrific era of mass incarceration in America that has been brought about by the politics of fear and anger. And in too many places across the world, we're being governed by people who preach fear and anger, and fear and anger are the essential ingredients of oppression and abuse. And we need a community of people to stand up against it. That's what human rights work is about for me. It's about challenging these conditions that have been so brutal, so toxic, so critically unfair. There are thousands of innocent people in our jails and prisons, and we're going to continue fighting for them.
Brian Stevenson was speaking from a civil rights exhibition put on by the Equal Justice Initiative in Montgomery, Alabama. The exhibition features hundreds of jars of soil collected from various lynching sites around the United States. You can see our interviews with Brian Stevenson, Anthony Ray Hinton, as well as watch the entire Right Livelihood Awards ceremony at democracynow.org. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. When we come back, Dr. Paul Farmer on the COVID-19 pandemic and his new book, Fevers, Feuds, and Diamonds, Ebola and the Ravages of History. Stay with us.
Just something I must do for a future. Always knew that it would be just so. I'll be counting the days, and I won't get used to a way before I say.
Misery's end. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We turn right now to a remarkable book. It's called Fevers, Feuds, and Diamonds. The United States has set yet another world record for daily coronavirus cases and hospitalizations, with over 216,000 infections confirmed Thursday and more than 2,800 deaths. Nearly 101,000 people are hospitalized with COVID-19 across the United States. In California, Governor Gavin Newsom has issued sweeping remain-at-home orders. The Navajo Nation has requested a major disaster declaration from the federal government, facing medical supply shortages and surging case numbers. Here in New York City, the positive test rate is the highest it's been since May, with officials warning of a second wave. On Thursday, President-elect Joe Biden told CNN he would ask Americans to wear masks for his first 100 days in office.
The first day I'm inaugurated to say I'm going to ask the public for 100 days to mask. Just 100 days to mask. Not forever, 100 days. And I think we'll see a significant reduction if we occur that, that occurs with vaccinations and masking, to drive down the numbers considerably.
President-elect Biden also announced Dr. Anthony Fauci, the director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, will play a key role in his administration's response to coronavirus. This comes as the race towards vaccination continues. Earlier this week, the United Kingdom became the first country to approve the use of the Pfizer-BioNTech coronavirus vaccine. Authorities said the first 800,000 doses will become available across the U.K. starting next week. As the U.S. also prepares to begin issuing vaccinations, starting with healthcare workers and nursing homes, concerns are growing about equitable distribution of the vaccine, especially to the global south. Well, for more on the COVID-19 crisis, we go to Miami, Florida, where we're joined by the world-renowned infectious disease doctor and medical anthropologist Paul Farmer. He's chair of global health and social medicine at Harvard Medical School and co-founder of Partners in Health, an international nonprofit organization that provides direct health care services to those who are sick and living in poverty. Dr. Farmer co-founded the group in 1987 to deliver health care to people in Haiti. In 2014, he traveled to West Africa to treat Ebola patients. Between 2014 and 16, Ebola killed more than 11,000 people, most in Sierra Leone, Guinea, and Liberia. In his new book, just published, about the Ebola epidemic, Farmer looks not only at the modern-day crisis, but at the decades of colonialism and extraction that fueled it. The book is titled Fevers, Feuds, and Diamonds, Ebola and the Ravages of History. Dr. Paul Farmer, welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us.
Thank you, Amy. It's great to be back.
Well, this is a true magnum opus. It is an epic work. And before we go deeply into what we can learn from, based on how Ebola was dealt with, I wanted actually to go to the epilogue of your book, which is what we are living in today in this country and around the world, this unprecedented pandemic. And as we speak today, Paul, all records have been shattered. Not in the poorest countries in the world, but right here in the wealthiest country in the world. Over 2,800 people have died. We have less than 5% of the world's population, but nearly 20% of the world's infections and deaths. How is this possible?
Well, I mean, we are facing the consequences of decades and decades of underinvestment in public health and of centuries of misallocation of funds away from those who need that help most. And, you know, all the social pathologies of our nation come to the fore during epidemics, and during a pandemic like this one, we're going to be showing the rest of the world, warts and all, how we have shown the rest of the world how badly we can do. And now we have to rally, use new tools that are coming online, but address some of the older pathologies of our care delivery system and of our country. I think that's where we are right now.
In your epilogue, you begin by saying the only means of fighting a plague, observes Dr. Hu, the protagonist of Albert Camus' novel set in a fictional Algerian city, is common decency. And I thought about that in relation to national policy. You have President-elect Joe Biden and Vice President-elect Kamala Harris yesterday talking about what they will do. Now, he has long known Dr. Fauci, who will play a key role. Vivek Murthy was just being named the Surgeon General. He's saying that for the first 100 days, they will ask the entire U.S. population to wear masks. And yet this flies directly counter to what President Trump is doing right now, who will hold scores of holiday parties inside the White House. The Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, has invited nearly 1,000 people to the State Department for holiday parties. Of course, this is inside. It's winter. We're not just talking about what the future will look like. President Trump is in office for another almost 2 months. When you have nearly 3,000 people dying a day, we're talking about tens of thousands of more needless deaths. What needs to happen right now in the United States?
Well, first of all, you know, I think that it's a great tragedy that such matters as masking or social distancing or even shutting down parts of the economy that contribute to risk, but are it's just a shame that that's been politicized. These are not political or partisan actions. They're public health strategies. Right now, they're all we've got. But even when the vaccine is online or begins to come online, we have no history of seeing a vaccine taken up so rapidly that it would alter the fundamental dynamics of a respiratory illness like this. So we're facing, as President-elect Biden said, a long, dark winter. And if we can make a difference that could spare tens of thousands and perhaps more than 150,000 lives, then we should do that. Whether or not these are called mask mandates or pleading from the president, we need state and local authorities to come together and underline the nonpartisan and life-saving nature of some of these basic protective measures. We need to invest very heavily in making sure the vaccine goes to those who need it most and those who've been shut out of previous developments like this or shut out for too long. So we have a lot of work ahead of us this winter, but no small amount of it is going to rely on individual families and communities to take up some of these measures rapidly to make sure that the dark winter does not lead to a blighted spring.
Dr. Farmer, can you comment quickly on these vaccines for people to understand the first what's called mRNA, messenger RNA vaccines, what they actually do in the human body? Do they make you immune, or you can get sick and be a carrier, but you yourself, you mean you can be infected and be a carrier, but you yourself will not get very sick? Explain the choice of who gets the vaccine, also the fact that this has not been studied in children, people under 14, and so what this means for kids?
Well, in general terms, let me just say that in the 30-plus years I've been involved in this work, I've never seen such a rapid development of a novel preventive for a novel vaccine. So there's a lot to celebrate in terms of the global effort to come together to develop new vaccines. Again, in general terms, the idea is that instead of having a natural infection, in this case, you know, breathing in the novel coronavirus and getting sick, which leads to the outcomes that we know, death or recovery with sequelae, it also leads probably to immunity. That's what it's like with other viral infections in humans, or almost all of them. So what the vaccine does is introduce something that will trick the body into believing that it's being invaded by the virus. In this case, it's focused on a particular protein on the outer surface of the virus, and generate that immune response, which is often robust and enduring, at least with other viruses. Now, in the case of any novel pathogen, we don't know for sure how long that immunity lasts, right? I mean, how could you? It hasn't been studied for long. But we know about other viruses and can take some lessons from those. And in the case of this new vaccine or this new type of vaccines, the mRNA vaccine, we're also dealing with that unknown. This is a new kind of vaccination. This is a new type, new approach. It's very exciting, in part because it seems to confer that immunity without significant adverse effects. So I think, again, on the side of development of a novel technology, these vaccines, whether mRNA vaccines or others, are great news, right? And maybe they will influence a new generation of vaccines for other pathogens, particularly viral pathogens, which tend to be the worst ones among humans. So that's where we are with the development of new technology. Unfortunately, as I said, and as you've underlined many times, Amy, the old pathologies of our society make it unlikely that the rollout will be smooth and evenly taken up across various communities, some of them with well-founded fears and mistrust of any kind of public health campaign. So we're in a bit of a pickle. I'm optimistic about what will happen in this country. But as you pointed out in opening up the hour, a lot of us are concerned with what's going to happen in the global south. And among those who might as well be considered living in the global south, in wealthy and egalitarian countries like the United States and parts of Europe. So it's going to be a rocky winter with some highs and lows, and I hope there are more highs than lows. I hope there's more reason for celebration than for grief. But I think it's going to be a very, very difficult winter.
On Thursday, the United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres criticized countries that rejected COVID-19 facts and the World Health Organization's recommendations.
From the start, the World Health Organization provided factual information and scientific guidance that should have been the basis for a coordinated global response. Unfortunately, many of these recommendations were not followed. And in some situations, there was a rejection of facts and an ignorance of the guidance. And when countries go in their own direction, the virus goes in every direction. The social and economic impact of the pandemic is enormous and growing.
So that's the UN Secretary General. I mean, it's very interesting that the United States, the most horrific record in the world now on COVID-19, and then Trump's allies in the world, Brazil, Jair Bolsonaro, you have Narendra Modi in India, you have Boris Johnson, who was in intensive care himself and then switched his kind of herd immunity approach, one that President Trump is taking in this country, not through vaccines, but through essentially just leaving the population and letting COVID-19 rip through our country. You have the science-denying leaders, a number of them authoritarian, and the effects in those countries. And also, though, places like the United States buying up the vaccines in the world. If you, Dr. Farmer, can talk about Trump pulling out of the World Health Organization, and also what that means when the wealthiest countries then buy up the available vaccines.
Well, first of all, wealthy countries buying up the available vaccines is nothing new. And that's why there have been a number of efforts to make sure that doesn't happen with these new crop of vaccines to prevent COVID-19. And that's going to be among the tasks that I mentioned for the coming months. And again, it will happen within countries in addition to between countries. Another thing that I would say as a sort of pushback is that vaccines do not require cognitive change to be effective, right? So whether you attribute COVID or polio or measles to, let's say, even sorcery or web—sorry, that sounds like a stretch, Amy, but it's something I've heard again and again. Once the vaccine is in you, it seems to work The same within those who understand the nature of the disease and its origins and those who don't. And that basic point, I think, is important because we do have to address vaccine hesitancy, but we don't have to convince people that, for example, this is an RNA virus that, you know, comes in through the respiratory route and that you can develop immunity. Those are parallel activities, if you ask me, to an effort to make sure that we have an equity platform, a global equity platform for distributing the virus, distributing the vaccine. And then back to the point that you made, which is about science deniers who are in leadership positions. That makes not only vaccine distribution difficult, it makes research difficult. It makes common and shared understandings of how diseases work difficult. So it's something that we should deplore and try to get rid of in our public discourse, but we still have to proceed with the vaccine distribution and knowing that it will not engender a lot of culture and cognitive changes in the short term. And that's something, you know, I saw, Amy, in West Africa during the Ebola crisis, where in very often, as you read in that book, very often people did attribute their illness or their family member's illness to events and processes that had nothing to do with an infectious pathogen. I've seen that all over the world. But when there were rules applied around social distancing, around PPE, around how burials were to be conducted, when those rules were applied, and when there was better care provided for those afflicted, that's when we started to see some decline in the incidence of Ebola in West Africa. And I just want to underline that we don't have to make everybody who gets this vaccine an expert in virology or vaccinology. We need to get them protected.
And just before we go to this remarkable book about dealing with Ebola and what it meant, I wanted to ask you about property rights, about patents, and about countries like in South Africa and India pushing for a temporary suspension of intellectual property rights and patents so that COVID-19 vaccines and medications become more accessible, particularly in the global south.
Well, I'd just like to say something we've had a chance to discuss before in previous years. You know, when you look at what happened around HIV, which, you know, by 1995, 96, those of us in the infectious disease world understood that this would be a life-saving suppressive therapy. Like, as with diabetes, requiring insulin, you'd have to keep taking it, but this would save millions of lives, and maybe even more, and prevent transmission of mother to child. The same debates about intellectual property, of course, came up then. The average wholesale price for a three-drug regimen in the years immediately after the discovery of these new agents was $15,000, sometimes $20,000 per person per year. So if you split your time between Harvard and Haiti, as I had and do, you would imagine, if you couldn't have an imagination beyond conventional property rights discussion, that the majority of the world would be shut out of access to this therapy. And of course, that made the most difference on a continent level in Africa, where the majority of people living with HIV and dying with HIV were at the time. And what happened later was the production of generic versions of these drugs, often in India or China or even South Africa, right, so that a much lower cost could be tied to the same agents. And when I say much lower, I mean a reduction really even within those early years from 15 to 20,000 to about $300 per person per year. And with groups like the Clinton Foundation getting involved, those prices dropped even further. And right now you can get a really good three-drug regimen, even with some pediatric formulations for children, for about $60 per patient per year. So that you could say that took a long time, but it didn't take a long time in terms of the impact that it could have Millions and millions of lives, maybe even 16 to 20 million lives, are being saved by these drugs. But in some places like Rwanda, where I've spent 10 years, you saw the virtual eradication of AIDS among children. Because if mom is on therapy, the transmission to babies in utero or through breastfeeding probably really does not occur. And this is not a hypothetical development. This has already happened in Rwanda, which is a very poor country with a very robust public health and care delivery system.
We're going to go to break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about fevers, feuds, and diamonds, Ebola, and the ravages of history. Our guest for the hour, Dr. Paul Farmer. Stay with us. Truth by Rance Allen. He just died in October. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Our guest for the hour, Dr. Paul Farmer, infectious disease doctor, renowned medical anthropologist, has written numerous books. I carried his uses of Haiti around with me in Haiti, and as I finished chapters, I would take them out of the book, rip them out to lighten my load, and leave them for people to read in different places. His latest book is Fevers, Feuds, and Diamonds, Ebola and the Ravages of History. Dr. Farmer is chair of global health and social medicine at Harvard Medical School and co-founder and chief strategist of Partners in Health, which works in countries around the world. Fevers, Feuds, and Diamonds, Ebola and the Ravages of History. Take us on the journey you took, Paul, as you wrote this book.
Well, you know, I wrote the book, a lot of it in Sierra Leone. And as chance would have it, and I think we talked about this in 2014, I was in Sierra Leone in June of 2014, but for an unrelated matter, I was there for a surgical conference, and which I was involved in part in organizing. And I remember folks coming to the conference saying, you know, there's already Ebola in the neighboring countries. Should we really have it as a safe venue? And my response was that you don't get Ebola through medical conferences, but through caregiving, that is, nursing the sick and burying the dead, and that we would be okay. Shortly after that, I left, went back home to Rwanda. And as you will recall, my colleague, Humar Khan, Sierra Leone's leading infectious disease doctor, died of the disease on July 29th. And I began lobbying my own friends and coworkers to join in on the fight. And so I will add, Amy, that we were very tardy to get there, in my view, and arrived in October. And what I saw then in both Liberia and Sierra Leone was just terrifying. It's not like there's a terror with a respiratory virus that's invisible. That terror comes when someone is sick and fell ill. But there in the midst of this clinical desert, you know, there were times when we saw people collapse in the street and knew that it was likely or possibly from Ebola, and with some shame, you know, waited for those fully masked and gowned to come and help people. Now, that was not during the time which would follow in a couple of weeks in the Ebola treatment units and community care centers and abandoned public hospitals. We're still doing a lot of that work today. But the reason I wrote the book was I got to know a number of patients quite well, and as they recovered, we became very often friends. That initial group that I met in October, and some that I met in Ebola treatment units in the course of the worst weeks of the epidemic. And one of them, a young man named Ibrahim, on the night that I met him, told me that he had lost more than 20 members of his family to Ebola and asked me to interview him. And even though, as you point out, I'm an anthropologist as well as a physician, that was a very unusual kind of experience to have someone who just had experienced such loss and was still recovering to make such a request. And that kind of convinced me that these stories from West Africa and the history of the place would be an important thing for me to learn about. And that was the genesis of the book.
And so talk about Ebola, the outbreak, and then how it was contained. You talk about it as the caregiver's disease.
Well, Ebola, like the coronavirus, is an RNA virus, and also likely both are zoonoses. That is, they come from other species, animal species, and then leap into humans. And if you look, stand back and look, a lot of the diseases that cause the highest number of deaths among humans have these zoonotic roots, and Ebola is one of those. Its natural host is still disputed. It may be a bat. That seems plausible. But in the midst of all that, its origins in what species it came from was not really the task at hand. The task at hand there was stopping transmission from person to person, because once introduced into the human family, Ebola spreads easily through contact. And the two main sources of exposure are caregiving. First, nursing the sick, cleaning up after them. And second, the last act of caregiving in most parts of the world and in most religious traditions is burying the dead. And those were causing the transmission. Now, the problem there, unlike the United States, is that there were not professional caregivers and there were not professional undertakers or morticians. So, of course, family members and traditional healers had to fill in that gap. And that's why so many people got sick and so many traditional healers got sick. And then, of course, the professional caregivers also experienced enormous risks. It wasn't just Dr. Khan. It was thousands and thousands of nurses, laboratory technicians, ambulance drivers, and doctors. And of the 1,000 or so that got sick during that time, probably more than half of them died. So that's again, another huge loss for any country. But if you're living in the medical desert and don't have a lot of physicians and nurses and lab techs and ambulance drivers, it's really something. Going back to the UN Secretary General's comments about COVID, the effects of that will be felt for years and decades if we don't step in and work to build those health systems again.
Certainly,
I don't know if that's a good
certainly, as we've learned, dealing with health, with epidemics, with pandemics, if people have any questions about whether altruism is a motivation, we just understand we are all connected. You, Dr. Farmer, talk in your book about colonization, the slave trade, the catastrophic consequences on African nations. Talk about, though this is not usually talked about in health terms, you put the two together.
Well, let me just start, Amy, by saying that during the epidemic, the great majority of our attention, and certainly mine, was on the clinical response. That is, trying to make sure that Ebola treatment units, at least the ones with which we were affiliated, were not only places for isolation, but places for care. And care for Ebola is not rocket science. Even without what are called specific therapies, like an antiviral, like remdesivir, for example, for COVID, even without specific therapies, the interventions that are required to save the lives of the majority of Ebola patients are to replace the fluids that they've lost through nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, sweating, right? The torrid heat of the area. All those losses of fluids and electrolytes are what really imperil the lives of those sick with Ebola in the short term. And we have therapies for that. They've been around for 100 years. They've been improved over time. You know, these oral rehydration salts, which you probably call Pedialyte, are important. And for those who cannot take oral medications because they're nauseated or vomiting or in a coma, there are IV solutions that can save lives in that manner. And even that was not happening across the region. And there were reasons for that, right? People were frightened, and anything that involved a sharp, that is a needle to put in an IV, for example, or a blood draw, poses some risk to healthcare workers, right? But it would have been better just to say, hey, we're frightened, because anyone in a right mind would be frightened. But instead, we started having arguments about what kind of care was the appropriate care. And the arguments, I mean, especially within the internet, what are called the international actors, which doesn't mean Academy Award-winning actors, but the NGOs and humanitarian groups that had flooded this region after the civil wars that afflicted it for some time, and then returned, obviously sometimes a different cast of characters, including ones that we know well, like the CDC, came back just a decade after this conflict ended to be involved in the Ebola response. And I've made the argument in the book that the response was hampered by the fact that the attention was largely to containment, not to care. And, of course, this generated very painful echoes from colonial rule, which in that part of the world was largely a 20th century phenomenon. This is not remote history, as you know. So in order to improve the quality of containment efforts, we should have focused more on the quality of care. You know, we're going to face that when the next epidemic of Ebola comes along.
Your description of people, the life histories of the Ebola survivors, is deeply moving. Can you talk about Ibrahim Kamara and Yabom Karoma, some of the people that you dedicate this book to?
Well, you know, it's not always been easy to talk about them. Because, you know, they endured such losses, and they were not easy to hear about. Of course, having been involved in their care, I thought I knew something about their losses, but it turns out there were many more. And I had an epiphany, which I'm embarrassed to share. But, of course, it wasn't long before we understood that every adult patient that we cared for who survived Ebola or didn't had also survived a brutal civil war. And when I started talking with Ibrahim, who is the very man I mentioned earlier, who's the person really in a way who inspired me to write this book, I couldn't believe the details and spent many, many months and in the case of Yabom, years interviewing and learning about them. And, of course, this happens over time. But Yabom's story was different. If I could just go back and say, Ibrahim was probably 26 when he fell ill with Ebola and did not have children of his own. His most grievous losses were his mother, his, you know, siblings, family members, grandparents, aunts, uncles. Yabom, on the other hand, was 39, and she lost, in addition to her husband, some of her children, her mother also, and other family members. And what I learned about these two was that they moved between villages and the capital city during the war, after the war, and even during the epidemic, because very often they were called to perform those caregiving services for afflicted members of their family. And again, in the case of those who perish, and who was going to bury them at the time that they fell ill, and this was in August of 2014. So they faced these impossible choices. Another reason it was difficult and painful to write about them, choices that I've never faced, like, do we respect our mother's dying wish to be buried in her home village? And, of course, that was also against the recommendations of public health authorities. But there wasn't enough in the way of assistance with caregiving or with respectful burial of the dead until later in the epidemic. And so their compassion led to their own infections and to infections among other members of their families. Now, I will add, Amy, that, of course, I still I'm still friends with these people, and they've recovered to varying extents. Yabom almost lost her eyesight as well, because, as I think we discussed in when we were together in August of 2014 to talk about Ebola, one of the complications is a blinding inflammation that can be readily treated with steroids and eye drops that cost, you know, pennies or a dollar to save someone's vision. So there were lots of complications, to say nothing of grief and psychological and emotional complications. There were lots of complications that endured in the months after the epidemic was declared brought under control.
Dr. Farmer, you write that every American and most Europeans who fell ill with Ebola in West Africa survived. Different mortality outcomes emerged from the same strain of Ebola, depending on care that was or wasn't available, depending on your country of origin. If you can explain this and then expand that to what we are seeing today in this country, for example, also on the issue of racial differentials and disparities.
Well, you know, this is something that I encourage my students to grapple with, or our trainees in clinical medicine, you know, which is case fatality rate. Because case fatality rate is a report card on the quality of the medical system, right? And there are many parts to that. Referral to a clinical facility able to manage complications. And we're going to be facing the same challenge in the coming weeks. If hospitals become saturated, if we don't flatten the curve, then they become overwhelmed. And not only do they perform more poorly in terms of caring for those sickened by the pandemic, or in the case of Ebola, the epidemic, they also fail to provide the services that people need for other problems, other illnesses and injuries. And we saw a lot of that during Ebola, but we've also seen it in the United States once our hospitals in New England and New York became overwhelmed. And that's, of course, exactly what happened in West Africa as well. It just happened earlier and more devastatingly. But that's just the first part of the equation. Case fatality rate is a marker, a report card on what happens after you get infected, right? We also have racial disparities and other social disparities, as you've noted, in risk of infection. So all along that noxious path, we have to make interventions that lessen the risk for infection, but also that lessen the risk for a bad outcome once infected. And I think that is the goal before us with COVID-19, just as it was a goal during Ebola. Now, why am I bringing this up as a controversial matter? Because if the report card is only about disease control, that is stopping the epidemic, and not about survival once infected, why is it that people would go to an Ebola treatment unit to be isolated if they fear they will not receive care? And the answer is they won't, right? And this was not new. Treatment centers and treatment units that were really isolation and quarantine facilities proliferated across the continent of Africa during under colonial rule and remained a feature there even after the end of colonial rule. And that pathology of focusing on disease control over care, I think, really weakened the epidemic. With coronavirus in the United States, on the other hand, we do have to look carefully at case fatality rate. As you've seen, it has been all over the map, and I believe it will be better during this current surge because people are more experienced, right? But we don't have a control over care.
We have pathology. 10 seconds, Paul.
We don't have a control over care system here. We have containment nihilism, giving up on containment too early.
We want to thank you so much for being with us, and there's so much more to discuss. I encourage people to read Dr. Paul Farmer's book, Fevers, Feuds, and Diamonds, Ebola and the Ravages of History. He's an infectious disease doc. He is a medical anthropologist. He is chair of global health and social medicine at Harvard Medical School, co-founder and chief strategist of Partners in Health, also featured in the documentary Bending of the Arc. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks for joining us.